I'm going to start today by discussing, if you remember right, there was a problem running some of the links on the page in the example we did Monday. And if you remember, it worked in Firefox but not Chrome. Well, usually when something like that happens, you know, I don't feel like taking class time to sit and troubleshoot it, because you never know if it's going to be like a 2-minute thing to figure out or if it's going to be a 10-hour thing to figure out. All right. But what I like to do, because it's interesting, is to spend a minute talking about exactly what's going on. If you remember, if you don't remember, let's pull up the two pages, or the page in two different browsers. So let me pull up page in Firefox and the same page in Chrome. Here we are viewing it in one of the two browsers. Let's see which one. This looks like Chrome. And when I click on a link, it gives me an error. It says error loading page. All right. Yet when I view this in Firefox, I don't get that error. I can go to those pages. Well, that's kind of odd. All right. So, I went to troubleshoot this. And keep in mind that I'm using the jQuery mobile framework. All right. That's our first assumption. And keep in mind also that this framework allows us to do transition. So we can like have it slide to the right, slide to the left. So obviously it's doing some things behind the scenes. If you remember, the framework consisted of us putting in some JavaScript code and some CSS code. So there's probably some JavaScript code going on, all right, allows for those transitions to happen when a link is loaded as part of a nav bar. So I could guess at that, and I could Google, you know, link problem, jQuery mobile, and so on. But that's not likely to give me a lot of insight into exactly what's going wrong. One thing I try to stress in all my classes is to have a systematic way of debugging your code. Alright? I was talking to a class yesterday and I said, you know, students tend to have two ways, and I'm not picking on students, you know, but even experienced developers do this. But there seems to be two ways that they debug code. One is to just stare at it until something jumps out at them. And the other is try a bunch of stuff until something works. Well, neither of those is necessarily the most efficient way of solving it. It's much better if you have a systematic approach for debugging something. And it's much better if you have, what do I want to say? If you take advantage of some tools that you have in debugging. Now, we all know you've all done ASP.NET, and you know there's a debugger there, right? So if you're doing this, if there was a similar problem in a Visual Studio app, we might set a breakpoint and see the debugger. What we can do here is we can look at, excuse me, we can go up and view, and this is in Chrome, tools, developer tools. And actually, specifically, the one we want isn't even in the developer's tools. It is in the JavaScript console. If I click on this, notice I get an error. HTML HTTP request can't load file, blah, 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 blah. Received an invalid response. Origin null is therefore not allowed. Well, that looks like something nice to Google, right? Instead of me trying to guess at what to Google, like link won't load or whatever. So I'm going to copy this. I am going to Google this error message.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Whenever we start using jQuery mobile, mm-hmm. will that work in an HTML validator? As validating our jQuery?
Yeah, it should.
Okay.
It should. If I Google this, we can read through this, and notice that it's an error in Chrome only. If we read these, let's see which one is a good one. This is a little bit different than what we're doing. And that does give the answer, but I want to find another answer. The problem is that we're not running this through a web server. All right? And jQuery is trying to open a file on our machine, right? The other URL, the other web page it's going to. And that mimics the behavior of cross-origin resource sharing exploits. If you look up, Wikipedia is a good site as any to get an intro to this. To the Chrome browser, this looks like it might be some sort of malware. All right? It looks like this could be some sort of malicious attack. It doesn't understand the fact that it's opening something on our computer. It sees it wants to open something on our computer and it panics, the Chrome browser. So we won't get that if we click around, but when we throw in that extra jQuery layer, given that jQuery is trying to load a file on our machine and not through the web server, it looks to the browser like this could be some kind of malicious attack, and therefore a security error prevents it from happening. All right? Now, there's a few ways to work around this. In a real world, you're not inviting everyone in the world over to view the web page on your machine. You put it out on a web server, and when you put it out on a web server, we're not going to have this problem anymore. In the meantime, we're just simply going to use Firefox, all right? Knowing that in a week or two, when we start talking about server-side stuff, this problem will go away, and we'll be able to view this page through Chrome and so on, all right?
Whenever you put up the error, like it said that there was a null reference, to me it almost seems like a GET request gone bad.
In a way, what that means in this particular case, if there's a null reference because it doesn't know what web server that code is coming from. Because it's not coming from a web server. It's coming from directly from our machine. So it doesn't know what server that code lives on because it doesn't live on a server. So that's what the error means in this context. The point is, number one, it was just interesting to me that it had this problem because I don't remember this in other semesters, so this must be something that was introduced in a more recent version of Chrome as compared to the last time. I think the last time I taught this class was a year ago. So within the past year, there must be an enhancement to Chrome to catch that sort of security issue. And the other interesting thing is just a preview or a review of some of the tools that you have available to debug, for example, the JavaScript console, where it can actually show you what errors get generated. And this is one that I don't know if I could have solved it any other way. I might have eventually Googled the right answer somehow, but I wouldn't have even really known what to Google. But with this, it gave me an error message. I can just Google that error message, and chances are good that it's going to put me eventually on the right track to a solution. So the bottom line is, we are, until we go in to using a web server, we are going to do this via Firefox. Let me see if we're running a web server here. It does not look like it. Oh? Kind of does, but it does. It looks like there's an install problem. If you want to try that, I won't take up class time, but if you want to try that, download this example, put it on your web server, and even in the Chrome browser, it should work.
Okay.
So if you want to verify that. All right, onward and upward. Last time we talked about jQuery Mobile, and again, Wikipedia has a nice write-up on cross-site scripting. Essentially, if you trust a site, and people have done this where they've embedded malicious code in like ads, right? You know, so you buy an ad for CNN or something like that, and you embed malicious code in it. Well, people download it, thinks the content's coming from CNN. Yeah, they trust that. CNN is not known to be in the virus business. Well, if the ad contains malicious code, then you can run into difficulty. All right, here's some more features that we're going to exploit with this. I want to go over a couple of things. I'm not sure if we'll get to all of them today, or we will cover more of them next time. First of all, notice that is red. All right, when we did this before, it was a different set of colors. So that's accomplished via a theme. All right, so if I look at this index page, notice there's actually a themes folder and file, and I have on that not a data theme of A, but a data theme of B, and that's why this looks a little bit different.
And that's the data theme.
I believe so, yeah. Actually, we could declare both of them, I believe. There's a default one, but then we can declare our own. And we'll take a look at doing that, probably towards the end of the class or next week. More important is a whole set of functionality that you get for free. All right? And we'll see that on the popular tartans page. First of all, on the top of this, there is expandable and collapsible sections. This is something I added to their example. Their example from the textbook doesn't have this in, but I wanted to demonstrate this, so I just added these sections, and they're good to go. With this, you can click on it to expand it, click on it to collapse it again. So in thinking of your assignment of reworking your one lab to use the jQuery Mobile framework, if you had a couple sections about responsive web design, you could, if you wanted to, if it made sense from a design perspective, instead of having one giant long page that the user would have to scroll and scroll and scroll to, you could use headings that you could collapse and expand as the user wanted to. So that would be a nice little piece of functionality you could put into, and that's a good way of putting more content on the page than an easy way to get a lot of content on page without taking up too much space. And the nice thing is, again, the JavaScript for this, the tough part is done. What do you suppose you have to do to make this work?
Put in your information.
Put in the information. Specifically, you have to assign some attributes to the HTML tags. So let's start out by looking at this. All right, we'll look at this, and we'll see how it's done, and then we'll move on to the next piece of functionality. So let's go and view the code for tartans.html. I thought I uploaded a updated version of this, but I guess I didn't. With the new jQuery mobile code in, but apparently I didn't.
You changed it in the last class.
Yeah, I thought I did that at home too. I thought I did it or here or wherever I worked on it and uploaded it, but I guess I didn't. All right. Okay. Notice what we have. We have a content data role. I have a div for a collapsible set. All right. A collapsible set is a group of headings that you can collapse and show. So I have a div for a collapsible set. Inside that div, I have other divs that have the data role of collapsible. So in other words, I have three things that I can collapse and expand. All right? Three things that I can collapse and expand. All right? And what's in each of the three things? I have a heading, in this case an H3, and then I have a paragraph tag. So, how does this work? Well, the heading becomes a thing that always appears, and the rest of the stuff, when I click on it, it appears, and when I click off of when I click it again, it disappears. So, in this paragraph, this is a code, or this is the thing that's going to be collapsible. How do I know it's collapsible? It's part of a collapsible set, so it's grouped together. So if we look at this, notice, and this may be a little difficult to see, but notice how all of these go together. They're all, section 1 has a rounded corner, section 2 has a rounded corner. They appear like a group. In other words, if I were going to do this again with a second collapsible set, let me copy and paste. It's pretty clear. I hope you can distinguish it.
Yeah, there's a little bit of a gap.
This is one set, this is another set. So the collapsible set sort of groups them together. And again, notice with this, the top one has a curved corner, this one doesn't have a curved corner, and the bottom one has a curved lower corner. All right? And then I can click on the heading to expand it and contract it again. All right? So I can make a collapsible set. Within each collapsible set, I can make as many collapsibles if I want. Do I have to put them in the collapsible set? Probably not. Let's try that. Let's get rid of the collapsible set.
You have two section twos in each of them.
Yeah, I know. So I counted wrong. Okay. Notice, because they're not in a collapsible set, each one has a little gap between it. I can still expand it and collapse it. So the collapsible set just groups them together and makes it look like a unit. So if you're thinking about this, again, one thing I normally do in many classes, I ask them to do the first assignment usually is to pick resources. So I could have, a heading for HTML and then have, a description of it and links to it. And then I could go in and put that stuff in a collapsible, and that would allow me to collapse it.
How do you feel about websites that use collapsible everything?
I would have to answer that. I would be more comfortable commenting on a specific website than in general. I believe anything you do can be overdone. All right. So when you say collapsible everything, that scares me a little bit.
All
right.
Like if you had all your sections of content in a collapsible unit, and then you had your navigation in a collapsible unit, and that was it. That was your whole web page.
probably wouldn't like that. One thing I have seen, let me see if I can bring it up.
Because I think LC's mobile website is like that.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't seen that in a while. One thing I have seen is like single page websites. That's just a long website that you scroll to.
Right.
And that can be effective. Again, it's more of a, how do I want to say it? It's more of a, you have to look if the technique works for the particular problem in a particular situation. But I will say the collapsible is one way that you can get a lot of stuff on the page. You know, what I would think would be a good use for this, all right, let's see if you, well, I'll tell you what I would think a good use of this would be. A news site, all right? A news site, I could have, you go to the homepage of it, I could have 10 news stories, all right? And the heading would, the heading would show the headline of it, and then I could choose which ones I was interested in and click on them and expand them. But I'd be able to see at a glance the top 10 news stories. Let's go and do that. Let's go and make that real quick. Let's make that page. Let's adapt this one to be a news page. And let me go and get the updated jQuery mobile files. Didn't want that. Didn't want that.
What do I want? Last time you just scrolled down and it was
there. No. Okay, here we go. This is the page. So let me go and copy this stuff in here. And I'm going to start with just the jQuery stuff, and I'm going to get rid of any of my style sheets or anything like that. So if I was doing this, let's say I was CNN and I wanted to have a news site. A very logical way of doing it would be something like this. See if I got rid of everything. There's our header. And let's HTML5 this. So I'm going to call this a, I'm actually going to get rid of this. I'm going to call this my header. So I'm going to make it, instead of a div tag, I'm going to make this a header tag. Make this an end header. I'm going to get rid of the links. And I'm going to go like this. section. Data role collapsible set. In section. Article data role collapsible something up. How about this? We'll say today's weather. Weekend weather. Then I could have another section for sports. We go and we can look at this. And we have something very plain like that. We have sports and weather, our two main sections, and then they're defined as collapsible sections, so the stuff in them is grouped together. And I click on Browns, I see the Browns article, Indians, I see the Indians article, and so on. Now, here's the interesting thing. The HTML for this is very logical, all right? And it even sounds like you're talking about like a newspaper, right? I have a section, sports section, the weather section. I have articles. The articles has a headline, and it has the text of the article. And so on. All right, and by doing it this way, you would have for a mobile device. Again, if we resize this browser window to be more appropriately a mobile device size, you see you have a very nice looking, simple and plain, but very functional little website using my HTML that I created and the jQuery mobile functionality. The hooks, of course, are the data roles. The data roles is what makes the magic happen. If I eliminate this data role of collapsible for this, then all of a sudden, that's not collapsible anymore. And you might want to do that in some cases, right? You might want to have like the top story that everyone sees, all right? And then have other less important stories that you could collapse or whatever. So you might want to do that within a selection and make something something's collapsible and something's not collapsible. But again, it's that data role that's the hook. It's a data role that connects my HTML with certain predefined behavior and appearances within jQuery Mobile. Questions about this?
Say you did something more complex.
Like what?
Like Fox 8 News. They
okay.
Their navigation bar going across,
uh-huh.
And they got all the drop downs of their collapsible subunits for that.
Okay.
I mean, how would you go about doing that?
Well, I don't exactly know what you mean, but what it likely could be is that instead of having one page that has all this stuff in it, you have links to a bunch of pages that are like this, all right? Or you have a link to a server-side script that passes like some code indicating this page is a sports page, this page is a weather page, and whatever, and that gets dynamically generated based on that and follows this framework. So again, the examples are simple, but you can take and you can extend these examples. That's what I encourage you to do in the lab. You know, we call these we call the homework assignments in these classes lab, and I like that name because that ought to tell you that you're encouraged to experiment and play around and try something, see what it works. All right. So this is sort of the simplest case. Remember, we're going to study all these different techniques, and all these techniques are available in jQuery, but you can combine them in a whole bunch of different ways. You know, I got rid of the navigation on this one, but obviously in a bigger site, you wouldn't get rid of the navigation. You'd have it on there. All right. And again, you could use some server-side code to do that. A lot of different possibilities for that. And in fact, anything but the header, I believe, will be collapsed. So if I had two paragraphs here for a story, both of them would be collapsed.
I'm just seeing like a lot of the mobile web pages nowadays having collapsible navigation and, you know, having one button bring up like a whole slew of links or whatever, you know. I guess whenever I see that, that's what I think of.
Right. Right. Do you have an example one that we could look at?
Well, I know like HuffPost has
okay.
A collapsible one for their mobile.
All right.
And like Target.com has a huge
okay.
Navigation and Fox 8 News.
All right, let's bring a couple of those up. When you click that, are we actually, I'm going to cheat and make that bigger. This is done via JavaScript, so this could be jQuery or something else, because if you notice, we're not moving to another page.
Okay.
All right. So the JavaScript would open that up, and then when we click on, or we can close it if we want. And then if we click on one of them, we go
and redirect
down that to a page. Yeah, if we click that, we're always bringing up this menu. So there's a snippet of JavaScript in there that is going in and displaying that.
I'm just seeing that as very common.
Yeah, it is. It is. And keep in mind, how do I want to put this? That one thing that's true is that there's definitely trends in web development, and there's definitely when something catches hold and a lot of people do it, a lot more people do it, all right? Because that gives you sort of the comfort of knowing that people are going to understand how to do that, if that makes any sense. I don't think I'm explaining myself very well.
Well, I see a lot more people using WordPress nowadays, too,
right,
rather than ASP.NET or,
right,
you know, other things like that.
Right. WordPress is a pretty common content management system, absolutely. But, like, for example, the convention of this meaning show the menu, you know, a lot of people do that. A lot of sites do that. So if you do that, then people instantly know that's where the menu is, and they don't have to guess. So, yeah, there definitely is sort of a snowball effect with some of these things.
It's almost like Microsoft Office and their new software every year.
Right. All right. So, there's an example, and again, I just went and added, you know, sort of broke this part out and showed how you could use it to be, you know, to do something a little more meaningful than just showing and hiding stuff, showing how it could be a section. The other functionality I want to look at on this page relates to searching. Actually, I'm going to eliminate that code from here, since we have a better isolated example. So let me get rid of these two collapsible sets. This is what the book had, for an example. Notice that there's buttons here. This simply takes the user to that other page. This calls a page that we don't have finished yet, but we can use. And again, notice with this, there's some form elements that are cool. Select a color. We can type in the color we want. All right, and then there's a back button. So we'll look at that, but first we're going to look at this. Notice, first of all, that there's a list here, and when we click on this, we go to see what that tartan looks like. So the Bruce tartan looks like that. Notice that they're alphabetized, and there's a line between them, A, B, C, D, and so on. And notice that we can search, we can filter. All right.
Wouldn't that be like a built-in database then?
Well, in this particular case, it's not a database. But what this is doing is, again, it's using the JavaScript that comes with the comes with the framework to show and hide things depending on what we put in there. Now, we could keep in mind that in this particular case, because they don't mean to teach a PHP in this class, but so in this particular case, all these are hard coded. However, I could have written a PHP code to read through and display all these tartans, reading it from a database or reading it from a directory listing or something like that. So this particular page is created as just plain static HTML, and it uses a jQuery mobile framework to get some of this cool additional functionality. But remember, anything that you can do as HTML, you can write a script to pull the data from somewhere and to create the same kind of HTML. So it's not like the two are in conflict. The jQuery mobile handles these sort of neat client-side user interface sort of things. And in this particular case, it's based on a static HTML file. But we could just as well use PHP or ASP.NET to create a page that uses jQuery mobile to do all this cool stuff. All right. Again, we'll notice the hook here is the data roles. So let's look. Take a look at this guy. Notice we have a UL. All right. We define then a list of LIs. And the LIs for the letters of the alphabet, we give a data role of list divider. So, this is what makes it appearance-wise look like this. Oops. Look like the A's look like that, the B's look like that, and so on, because we've given them a data role of list divider. Data filter is set to true. So I don't have any HTML at all for this search box. I didn't create that text box in my HTML code. How is it created? The framework created it by me simply saying, I want to be able to filter this. So this is a list view that I want to filter. So I set the data role to be list view, and I set the filter to be true, data filter true. If I eliminate this, if I eliminate the data filter true, then text box disappears, and I simply have a list of items. But if I put in the attribute for this, the data filter of being true, then it knows, hey, I want to filter it. So it generates a text box for allow you to search through or filter through the list. And it also generates a Java code, JavaScript code that allows the list to be filtering. So as I type something here and I click, let's click refresh.
Would this affect how a search engine would go through your page?
No. Because it's just going to crawl the page and it will see sort of the fully expanded version of it as it looks at it. Right? Because it's, excuse me. The search engine isn't going to be using this filtering functionality. The search engine, when it goes and scans it, is just going to see the HTML code. Notice how this works. As I type something in, it dynamically narrows it down. So I type in an A, it shows me everything that starts, or I'm sorry, everything that contains an A. I type in a B, it shows me the things that have an AB in it. All right, so it does it dynamically. And again, this is functionality that is built into this. Also built into this, because I've made this a list view and I've defined it as a link, I get the little thingy there as indicating that that's a link as opposed to just a plain old list item. So, for example, if I were to get rid of the link here for Abercrombie, to get rid of that, don't have the little arrow there because it's no longer a link. So I didn't specify, hey, I want an arrow with that. I specified that that's a link because it's a link that is part of a list view. It gives me that little arrow indicating that that's a link, and if I click on it to treat it as a link and go to that page. Now, we saw last time how we could add transitions to this. So as it stands now, if I click on it, simply loads that page. But I could go and use a transition to transitions, data transitions, what was that one, flip, let's try that. That's a good question. I would think I would put it on the link. Say slide up. It is possible that this is something that is not supported by this browser. So let's say slide up. Doing anything, but I could be mistaken. All right. So any kind of searchable list that you might have, whether it be for products or for people or for classes or something like that, you could do the filtering to do it, and you could create a link to another page. Questions about this? Again, keep in mind, we're going over these examples to illustrate what the capabilities are. It's giving you more and more tools in the toolbox, so to speak. It's your job as you develop mobile pages, and it's your job, like for this assignment, to look at the particular kind of page you have and decide what makes most sense for this. Does it make sense to have collapsible? Does it make sense to, you know, have a navigation bar? It's up to you to decide what's the best way to organize the material for this and what technique you want to use for this. Questions? Let's look at creating a theme for this. All right? You can think of a theme as sort of like a color palette that you're going to make available. So, I'm going to go back to the news page and do this. All right? The one that I created today. So, I'm going to go back to my news page, and I'm going to create a theme. All right. So, if I go here under jQuery Mobile, there's something called the theme roller. And a theme roller allows us to graphically create the theme so that we can include it on our page. So let's go in here, and what I have is I have the default for the theme. I have my A theme, which looks like that. I have my B theme, which looks like that, which is the same as the A theme, and so on. I think you have A, B, C, D, E, and F. I think you have... maybe I'm wrong. All right. Let's go and let's play around with this a little bit. Let's say I want to make this thing I want to make the header. Right now the header is set to kind of a gray. Let's say I want to make the header be kind of a dark green. Body text. My mistake. I made the text. That wasn't obvious. Let me go in. Let's make the text red. Alright, there I made it red. I can make the background. That's what I thought I was working with. I can make the background some color. Let's go with that. Not saying it's the best looking color scheme, but I can make a shadow for this. So I can make a black shadow to this if I wanted to. And I can make the shadow be bigger or smaller. So then I make body, I can make the background of the body be some color. Oh, that's border, I'm sorry. Background be some color. And so on down the line. I can make links look a certain way, I can make buttons look a certain way, and so on down the line. So I can make several of these. Alright. There's my A theme. There is my B theme. I can make the B theme. And I can make the page, the background for this guy, let's say to be that color. The back, the header bar, I could make. Let's make it black. That's the text. Let's make the text white. Let's make the background of this black. So I can define several themes for this. Okay? And then when I'm done, I click download. And what it will do is it'll tell me, and it'll tell me where to put this stuff too. I'll click download zip. I need to put a name in. Download zip. It'll download that zip file. And I need to include the themes folder and I need to put those two lines of code in my source code. So I can go into news, let's say, edit with notepad, and I can put those guys right here, I believe. Oops. Now if I save this and open it up, all right, I get the basic default look. And if I want to specify,
so that's where the A, B,
if I can then specify the data theme of A, B, C exactly. So I can go here, and I can say, I want this header to have a data theme equals A. Let me go and double check the syntax on that. That's a good question. I am not 100% sure. Not sure if you put that on the body, if that would do it. It's a good question. I'd have to look at that. Nope. Still ain't working. I'm not sure what I am doing wrong with this.
Do you have to reference your theme file?
That's what I'm doing here in the style sheet. And I'm referencing the icons in there as well that was generated. So I am referencing the theme. I am. Let's try this. Let's put it on the body and let's see what we get. Because that was one possible answer, I thought, to your question of how to do it for everything. I could put it for the body. That's also isn't working. Let me try a capital A. Okay, I am not sure why that isn't working. I'll have to do some review on that. Let me open Chrome just on the odd chance that there is some issue with Firefox. Okay, doesn't seem to be. I am not sure why that isn't working. I'll look into that and do that for an example. Again, the idea is that you can specify different looks for that. Thinking in terms of server-side scripting, though, you could make it to allow users have the choice of how they want to view your site, to skin it, if you will, to theme it. And then once you picked it, you could remember that in their profile, and so when you served up the page to them the next time, you could set it up with that data theme. So I should just be able to put data theme in there and have it work. I'm not really sure why it isn't. I'll have to look at that and verify. I'm probably doing something dumb. Any questions? What we will look at next week will be what?
Oh, I got a quick question.
Yeah.
Say we do a data theme on the elements of the page, but we wanted to do like a desktop version of a theme.
Mm-hmm.
Would we have to specify a different style sheet?
Yes.
That's where the media query would be.
That's where the media query comes in, or that's where having two different web pages and having a redirect between the mobile version and the desktop version could come in. So one of those two. What we are going to do next time, and why, let me see, because the themes are working on this, data theme A.
Did you insert them in the wrong place?
I don't know. The old themes are working here.
Maybe you inserted them before the scripts.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a possibility. At any rate, the other thing that we'll look at next week, we'll continue our discussion of this, and we will look at forms controls, because there's some neat things that we can do, such as a slider, where we can pick a number, a drop-down that shows me a list of colors, and so on.
And we're going to be doing this via JavaScript?
Well, we'll be doing it the same way. We'll be creating our standard stuff, and we'll be assigning roles to the different elements and let the jQuery mobile stuff do it for you.
Okay.
All right. Questions about anything here? All right, going once, twice, sold. Okay.